Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode, another video about water, being watered by the word. The Bible says that Jesus wants to sanctify us and cleanse us by the washing of the water of the word. You know, when we get into God's word every single day, that's what helps us grow closer to him. That's what helps us purify, right, and get better. And we realize, we look at the Bible as like a mirror, right? And we can look at it and we can see ourselves for who we truly are and see what we need to change about ourselves and see how we need to be different. And James, he uses that exact analogy. He uses, like, if you look at the Bible, if you read it, if you study it, if you try to learn from it, but then you walk away and you don't change anything, it's like the same thing as like waking up in the morning, right? And your hair just like all a mess and your clothes are all disheveled. You got like slobber, like stains coming down the side of your face, right? And then you look in the mirror and you're like, all right. And you walk away and you don't do anything to change yourself, right? To make yourself look presentable. Same thing goes when you look at the Bible, right? If you get into the Bible, you dig into it, you see what Jesus wants you to do with your life and how you want you to change, and then you don't change anything, you know better, right? And so that's why we get into the water of the word every day. That's why we let it cleanse us. That's why we let it change us. That's why we meditate on it. And so last time we were in chapter 13 of Luke and verses 22 through 30. And we talked about the narrow path, the narrow way. And we talked about how you need to have a relationship with Jesus, right? The master of the home didn't let the people in because he had no relationship with them. And same thing, if we don't have a relationship with Jesus, there's no way we're getting let into heaven as well. And so from there, Jesus kept teaching. And so we get to Luke chapter 13, and today we're going to be in verses 31 through 35. Luke chapter 13 and verses 31 through 35. This is what it says. The same day, there came certain of the Pharisees saying unto him, get thee out and depart hence, for Herod will kill thee. And so this is what's going on. You have these Pharisees. Remember, these are these hyper-religious people. They're hypocrites, and they hate Jesus, right? So they say, get out of Jerusalem, because Herod's going to kill you, right? They're trying to get Jesus out of Jerusalem. They don't like him. They are out of this place. They do not want him there. So they're like, get out. Get out. Herod's going to kill you. And so this is Jesus' response. And it's one of, like, the harshest responses that Jesus has ever given. But listen to what he says. He sends him, you go and tell that fox. So he calls Herod a fox, which is, it's not like he's saying a good thing. It's kind of like a bad thing. And he says, behold, I cast out devils and I do cures today and tomorrow and the third day, and I shall be perfected. Nevertheless, I must walk today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet perishes out of Jerusalem. So what Jesus is talking about, he's giving these analogies and this idea, one, that he's a prophet of God, that he is a true prophet and he's come to give the true word of God. But two, he's calling back history, the history of Israel. And so this is what he goes on to say in verse 34. It said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, which kills the prophets and stoneth them, or stones them that are sent unto thee. How often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen does gather her brood under her wings, and ye would not. He said, behold, your house is left to you desolate, and verily I say unto you, you shall not see me until the time come when you shall say, blessed is the Lord that cometh, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. So what is Jesus talking about? So Jesus, first, he sets himself up as a prophet, and he says, I'm going to keep going, okay? It's not my time to die yet. And we all know that a prophet's not going to die outside of Jerusalem. And so what is he trying to say here? He calls back this idea in verse 34 that Jerusalem kills prophets. Okay. And he says, and you stone them that are sent to you. So here's what happened in the Old Testament many times, right? Many times God would send these prophets to Jerusalem, to Israel as a whole. The northern and southern kingdoms, he would send these prophets to give the word of God, to tell people to repent, to turn around, to listen to what God is trying to say. And guess what? Over and over and over and over, they persecuted those prophets, right? Killed them, cast them out, disregarded anything that they had to say, didn't listen to them at all, over and over and over. And you can go back through the Old Testament and you could read through those different prophets, those different books where you see these prophets that are giving these great words of God, right? Telling everyone what they should be doing and telling everyone how they should be living for God. But guess what? They just ignore them. They ignore them again and again and again. And so here's what happens, right? Here's what happens. What happens is over time, those nations, the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom, right, of Judah, they all get worse and worse, right? Bad things continue to happen to them. People keep attacking them. Finally, it comes to the point where both the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, this nation of Israel that's been split into two through civil war, both of these kingdoms get attacked and taken away captive by foreign powers, right? Where their nation is no more. And this happens because they didn't listen to God. They didn't listen to the words of the prophet. Look what Jesus says here in verse 34, in the last part. He says, "How often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen does gather her brood under her wings." And so what he's saying is, this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to gather you together in my protection. If you've ever seen a chicken, that's what they do a lot of times. Like, you know, if there's like a dog that runs by or something like that, and a chicken's got all the chicks kind of come to the mother hen, and the hen covers the chicks with their wings, right? I remember this one time when I was a kid, sometimes like ducks and geese will do the same thing. When I was a kid, me and my brother and sister, we were actually in Florida and we were going to Disney World. So we were staying in this like little condo apartment thing. And then outside of it, they had this little pond, and there is this mama duck, right? And she had just had babies. And so there's this huge line of these babies that are following her around everywhere. And what me and my brother and sister would do, because we're like evil, we would run and we chase after those little chicks, right? We didn't really understand that that was probably very stressful on those little chicks and the mama. But a lot, that's what they would do. They dart to the water, and the mama would sometimes turn around and, you know, quack at us, or she'd gather them under her wings to protect them. She was doing everything she could to protect her chicks. Same thing like a hen, a mother hen. She's doing everything she can to protect those chicks. Same thing with a mother. A mother does everything she can to protect her children. And so what Jesus is saying here is this, you know, as God, he wanted to protect his children, the Israelites. He wanted to take care of them. He wanted them to be safe. He wanted them to flourish and have everything they needed in life. He wanted them to be blessed. That's what he wanted. He wanted them to be blessed. That's why he was sending the prophets to them in the first place, to tell them, hey, here's some laws to live by that are for your good. And a lot of times we look at the laws of God and we think, man, God's trying to restrict us or put us in a box, right? That's not what he's trying to do. He's trying to protect us. You know, when you drive down the road, there's these lines in the middle of the road, right? And those roads aren't put there, or those lines aren't put there to, you know, keep you in a box and keep you from swerving all over the road, right? It's like they were trying to restrict our freedom. That's not why they put there. They're put there for your protection, right? Because if you start swerving to the other side of the lane, chances are what's going to happen? You're going to crash into another car. And so they put those lanes there. They put the curves and they put the lines on the road as a way of protecting you and protecting others. That's why God gives us laws. It's not to control us. It's not to keep us boxed in or prevent us from having any fun. And a lot of times that's the way we look at God and we look at his laws. And it's so wrong to look at it that way. The reason God gives us those laws is for our protection and for our good. My boys, we have what's called a papazon chair, right? And what it is, it's this round chair and has a big cushion in it. And it sits on a base. Now, if you ever, you can look it up, papazon chair. They're really comfortable, really cool, especially if you just want to lay back and read a book. It's awesome. But my boys love to climb up on it. Well, here's the thing. It's super light. First off, the top is super light. And the base and the top aren't actually connected. And they do that so you can kind of move it around so you can sit more straight up, or you can lay it farther down if you want. Now, my boys love to climb up on it. But here's what happens. They have no sense of balance when they're in this papazon chair. And so what they'll do is you got to be balanced in the middle over the base. But if you're not, you're going to walk out to the edge and that whole thing will flip. And so inevitably, Judah will get up in there somehow. He'll start crawling around and he'll get to the edge and that whole thing will flip on top of him and it'll hit his head and he'll get boxed in like a cage and he's like starts crying. So what we have to do is we have to tell him, no getting on the Papasan chair, Judah, Zion 2, no getting on it. Don't get on it. Now, Tekoa, he's old enough to get on it and doesn't do that. But the rest of them, no. And so we have to tell him, Judah, Zion, do not get on them. And we give them that rule. Why? Because we're not wanting them to have fun? No, we want them to have fun. And there's other benches and other chairs that they could climb on and sit on. But the reason we don't want them to do that is because they get hurt when they do it. Over and over, they get hurt. That's why God gives us those laws. He gives us laws for our protection and for our joy and for our good and for us to be blessed. But here's what Israel did, right? God, prophet after prophet after prophet, he sent to Israel, telling them to repent, turn from their sins, from their evil ways, and follow God completely. And time after time, they totally rejected God and his law. So what happened is eventually they were destroyed. They were left desolate and not blessed. And so this is what Jesus says in verse 35. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. It's destroyed. It's over. That's what he's saying. That is a hard thing. And that's what happens to us too. If we refuse to follow the laws of God that he's given us, if we refuse to follow his guidelines, his laws, his commands, our lives are going to end up the same way. You know, I look at people sometimes that are living in their sins and, you know, I want them to come out of it. Not because I want people to think like me and I want them to affirm what I think. No, I want them to find joy and peace and I want them to be blessed. And I know the only way that that truly happens is through Jesus Christ and following his commandments. You know, there's so many people out there that are stuck in their sins and it's leaving them desolate. Whether they're addicted to wealth and fame and so they lose their families to it, whether they're addicted to drugs and alcohol, and so they lose their families and their lives to that, or they're addicted to themselves and self-pleasure, and over they have to just seek something else and seek something else, and they're totally unsatisfied, right? So here is, that's this idea, right? The idea is that God gives us these laws for our protection and for our blessing, and this is why we must follow him, so we don't become desolate. Look what Jesus says at the end. You shall not see me until the time come when you shall say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. There's going to be a time coming when the Bible says that every knee will bow to the Lord and every tongue will confess to him. There's a time coming when everyone is going to know who Jesus is, when everyone is going to bow to him and worship him. And if we're not careful, what we'll do is we'll wait till it's too late. We won't worship the Lord. We won't trust him as our Savior. We won't follow his commands, and our lives will become desolate instead of blessed. The question is, what kind of life do you want to live? Do you want to live a life that is truly blessed? Or do you want to live a life that gets destroyed time and time again? Choice is up to us. Are we going to follow the Lord with our lives, or are we going to reject him? Okay, let's pray and we'll be done. Lord, thank you so much for this day. I thank you for just giving us the opportunity to be blessed. And I pray all these things in your son's name. Amen. See you guys later.